So this morning, I have the pleasure not only of enjoying the warm Lancashire sunshine, but also to meet a fantastic chef in the form of Lisa Rollin. How do you do? Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Or indeed, good afternoon.
Yeah.
Interestingly, we've not met before.
No, we haven't. This is the first time.
And of all the chefs that I've bumped into and worked with and interviewed and assessed food when I was in my AA days, it's just amazing we haven't crossed paths before.
I know. It's quite strange, isn't it? Considering that the chefing industry is like...
Yeah.
It's just impeccable for things like that, isn't it? Coming across people that you used to work with or making new friends, that kind of thing.
Yeah. So the first question is just to... for those like me who haven't met you before, just give us an overview of your career and how it began, how it started, how you fell into it.
Well, I wasn't very academic at school, so I found myself falling into things like practical things, like I was quite good at art, anything that involved being very practical with things. And cookery was one of those as well, home economics. It was something that really brought the passion out in me as well as my creativity. So I had an option to go to college when I was 16, which was Lancaster Morecambe College. I went there for 3 years and did a diploma. But in the time I was there, I was kind of one of these that's very keen and eager. And when I see something, to like do something a bit different or learn as much as you can out of getting the most out of things, I'd go and do work experience or ask people if I could join things just to see the outside world and go and have a bit of experience, really. So I did a few stages. While I was at college, Lancashire Morecambe College, I took a job at Hobart Gill, which was a one star in the lakes, so I was doing that at the weekends or any holidays or at nights when I wasn't at college, which really gave me a good grounding of what was a real kitchen like, you know, because from the things you learn at college and then seeing a real kitchen, it's kind of a different eye-opener. And it was really good experience. From there, I did a lot of different experiences. One of them was I went to Shara Bay and did a couple of months, a month there. I also went to the Cheltenham, the Champignon Sauvage, which was a one star at the time. He invited people to go on the race week because he needed extra students, because my lecturer used to work there, so we had that connection. And I went at once. I was actually out the front because there was no vacancy in the kitchen, so I thought, right, I'll go out the front just to see, you know, what the kitchen was like. And when I had my time off, I went in the kitchen and made pre-starters and stuff with him, and was quite keen to learn. So the next year came around and he asked me to go in the kitchen for a week. So I went and worked there for a week. And then by the end of the week, he offered me his job as his commis chef. From when I finished college. So when I finished college, I took a job at the Champignon Sauvage, which was with David Everett Mathias.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
and what a star.
It was a real learning curve because he'd just got his second star. He's so passionate about food and he oozes that. And to learn from someone directly on the stoves, teaching you about the stuff he used to forage or the raw ingredients that he uses. And because it was such a small kitchen, it really gave you an insight of what people can do with food and how the passion infused through his food.
Yes.
And his knowledge was just impeccable.
Okay.
So it was great, and I stayed there for about just over a year with him, and then I came back to sunny Lancashire looking for a job, and I started at Northcote as a demi chef de partie.
Interesting.
So I came here and, you know, as a young gun, thinking, right, okay, I'm going to spend a year, get my head down, and I'm going to travel to Spain and I'll go to France and I'll go everywhere. But I actually came here, I enjoyed it, and I've been here ever since, which is nearly 12 years in September.
Really?
Mm.
What were the name of your lecturers?
The lecturers I had was Robert Marshall Slater. He's now at Kendall College.
I know him really well.
He's a great guy, isn't he?
Yeah.
Again, you know, it's really good to learn from people that are so enthusiastic and really, you know, just speak volumes about food and what you can do and your techniques. And it, at such a young age, to have some people like that, your peers, really helps you grow and want to get the best out of it.
Thank you. bring it over to young chefs is when you leave college, it's really difficult to begin with, and as you'd expect, and certainly in the top kitchens it is. When did you feel that the light bulb moment came for you, when, you know, when your muscle memory began to kick in, when you knew that the food was going to behave itself, when you knew that, like, the basic principles of the science were coming together? How far into your career would you say?
I think you're always learning about food, and for every person I'd always say, like, every day is a school day, so you're always learning, you can always pick up new things and techniques. And I think for me, when you're a chef de partie, you've got involvement and you've got responsibility. Mm. And that's when you learn that how much responsibility you start to take within a kitchen.
Yeah.
And also, you know, I was 23 when I took over as head chef here. And it was real big responsibility, a lot of pressure, and that just adds up. So you're not actually just cooking and doing the food, you've actually got the responsibility of all these chefs in the kitchen,
yes.
Which was a really big learning curve for me. And also it makes you grow up a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And I think to have the two together, that was probably a moment where you actually realise and stand back. But you're always looking at different people within the industry, your peers that are always there to, you know, have new experiences and just learn from the whole thing, really. So I think even though I am a head chef now, every day I'm still learning new things.
How long have you been head chef here?
Probably about 8 years now, 8 or 9 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
I never ask a lady her age, but I think people might be able to work it out now.
Yeah, I'm actually 32.
Okay, great, yeah. Okay. Yeah. What do you think of the impact of chefs on TV? Is it a good thing or is it a bad thing? How do you think the consumer sees it, and how do you think the industry sees it?
I think chefs on TV is becoming more and more now because of all the programmes that are coming out, but it's not your programmes that are like Ready Steady Cook, it's your programmes like a Great British Menu, because that really shows a chef in its true colours, because they're given a remit to say, right, okay, you cook some fantastic food and it's your food. And it gives people out there an insight to actually how much effort and how much they go into and what food actually really means to them. Mm. So I think programmes like that are really good. But then, you know, you get your other programmes that are not that much involvement within food. Like, your Ready Steady Cook's good because it's for all your younger clients that really see you out. That kind of thing, I think. The Great British Menu, to me, was just a fantastic experience.
Mm.
You know, and it gave you a lot of things. It was hard pressure. You know, you wake up at night thinking of things that you were going to do, or like, oh my God, what if they say this? So there was a lot of pressure to cook in front of cameras, because it's different from when you're in your own environment. But the added things were the fact that you met so many lovely people. Mm. You know, you met new chef friends. Especially the first one I did, it made you go out and use different suppliers. You weren't allowed to use any that you already knew, and you were given a certain area. And it made you go out and find some different people. And it makes you realise of actually how many family-run businesses that don't get that much advertisement or published, because they're so small, that are doing some fantastic products.
Okay.
And it's a real, I think it was a real boost for the industry for that, you know, particular one we did. So yeah, it was really good, really good.
Do you think Great British Menu is more entertainment, or do you think it's practically encouraging the public to go out and start buying the kind of things that you can play with?
I think it's encouraging, because there might be some ingredients or a different piece of kit that no one's seen before, and you didn't have programmes like that, and now you're actually seeing it, because, you know, you wouldn't see on certain programmes like what Simon Rogan used, you know, all these different bits of experimental kit, you know, even from some of the quite quirky stuff or to some of the traditional things. But it's also ingredients. I think people might turn their nose up if they've never heard of it before, like something quite funny, or use ox tongue or something like that, but when they see it involved and worked, and actually it's a tasty product,
that's really interesting.
It makes you want to go out and buy it, or it makes you want to actually think, well, that's quite interesting, you know, let's see if we can have a look at that.
Okay. Why is it that, in my view, there's not enough top female industry leaders in hospitality? What's your view on that?
I think more and more women are coming into the industry now. And I think it's the fact of, some people would say the hours, some people would say that it's a male dominating environment. And I think at the end of the day, anyone can do it, whether you're female or male. You've just got to have that passion, that vibe. And yeah, it is working long hours, and there's a lot of effort to be put in. And I think, you know, it can be a mixture of anything, really. It depends what kind of person you are. For me, I just think, you know, if you want to achieve something, it doesn't matter whether you're female or male, you know.
Absolutely.
You just got to really go in there and pack it with a punch.
Do you think male cooking and female cooking have got different dynamics? Is one more, can you detect a more masculine feel about a certain type of cooking, or is there any difference?
I think it'd be very equal, really, because I think it's down to the chef and their touch. Because people do say, you know, females have got a very feminine touch, but then you can look at some of the greater chefs, you know, that have got softer touches as well. So it's quite interesting to see, really. It gives a light off, doesn't it, really?
Yeah, no, it's certainly in my travels, I have discovered there is a softer touch from females.
Yeah.
But it's only where that the female in question has been to the mise en place. If you're serving food that's cooked by a whole team of different individuals.
Yeah.
Okay, what do you think about hospitality education or culinary education in the UK at the moment?
I think now that people are cottoning on to the education for people, I think a few years back there wasn't that much. It was a lot dry, wasn't it? People didn't really focus in on the schools, but now you're getting a lot of chefs that are going into schools and they're teaching, or they're going into colleges and they're doing demonstrations or masterclasses. And I think it's really important that the students get that, to actually see what a real kitchen is like, because it's completely different from when you go into a college and they'll ask you to make a hollandaise or a béarnaise or something like that, and then you come into a kitchen and it's a different environment completely.
So why? I've been having these discussions with people in education recently, and I don't know what the answer is, but this is our view, is that you go to college and you learn to make a roux.
Yeah.
And the roux goes back to 1912 when Goffier released his modern classic cuisine. But why wouldn't you want to teach them how to use Ultratex or some other much more efficient thickening agent? And so if you go through all that, why is choux pastry taught over pâté brisé? Or so how much, when you receive young kids from college, how much of an adjustment do you feel that you have to make, basically?
I think, you know, there is quite a lot of adjustment, because at the end of the day they come out knowing the basics, but like it's just you've said, really, it's making a roux and different things. They don't know about the today technology, about water bathing, about the techniques, or even using a classic thermo. They might think it's just for a blender, when the thermo is an amazing piece of kit, you know.
Isn't
it can do a lot of things. And I think it's about the college changing the times a little bit to work with more chefs like they are doing now, to evolve the different techniques and the different ingredients that can be evolved nowadays in food, because it's moving all the time. I mean, I always say to people, like, food's like clothes, isn't it? The trends come in and out all the time.
You say that. Like, our view is that, just take these fantastic drapes we have behind you, classical in design, modern pattern.
Yeah.
And that is actually your food.
Because
we've just enjoyed a really fantastic lunch. The heritage of Lancashire that comes out of your food, the heritage. Some of your flavours are sort of waking up my DNA. You know, they're so spot on. And what really comes across in your cooking is exactly what you said, is that you're keeping to the flavour combinations that work, and then you're applying modern technology onto those to make them really shine. How long has it sort of taken to get to that point?
I think it takes a while, because you've got to, for me, you have to learn the modern techniques and then put them to your dishes. But there's a lot of people that would use too much of it, so they put a foam in a jelly here and go absolutely mad with it. And I think the foams and jellies are great, but use them in moderation to enhance your dishes, to make them better and not to overload them.
Yeah.
So I think it's about learning the balance of it. And actually, before I've learnt what maybe the ingredient or the new stabiliser or a new gelling agent, before I've learnt on how to use it, we'll never put it on a dish. And then you apply it.
Mm.
So you can actually experiment with it, which is quite good fun, because then it does this, it does that. Well, actually, it might work quite well with this, so let's have a go at it.
Mm.
And I think that's the fun about it. But also, you need to do that to keep your food moving.
Mm.
And I think, you know, for me, I am very much regional, as well as Nigel. We work very closely with a lot of local suppliers because they've got some fantastic ingredients.
Mm.
And when you go and visit them and you see the ingredients out in the fields, or actually, you know, all the cheese in the cold rooms and stuff.
It's great, isn't it?
Yeah, it makes you want to actually make that ingredient shine when it goes to the plate. You might use something quite quirky, or you might do something quite traditional with it. And I think that's the greatest thing about food, is that, you know, you can do something quite simple with it, but really, you know, make it shine.
Very good.
Doing different techniques and keeping on top of your game, really.
Very good. Fun now, if you could go and eat at any restaurant in the UK, no expense spared, where would you go right now?
To eat, or
yes.
Yeah, to yeah. Eat. I don't know, I went to Sat Bain's for my 30th, and his food was great. You can just see, and now he's a chef that's evolving all the time.
Absolutely.
You know, from 6 years ago when I went to eat with him, to now. He's just impeccable what he's done with the building, with his food.
Wonderful, isn't it?
And he's always looking for new things, and he's an enthusiast.
Mm.
You know, his book is just absolutely dynamite. And I think they're big inspirations, so somewhere like Sats would be, you know, definitely go and eat there.
And if you could go and dine anywhere in the world right now, where would you go?
I like the States, I like America, because I think the food's really up and coming. You've got some fantastic chefs over there. 11 Madison Park. I went to Chicago a couple of years ago and did like a culinary tour
fantastic.
With one of my friends. So I set off from Manchester, went to Chicago. I ate at Alinea, which just, it blew me away. And again, he's another guy that, very gimmicky, but with the gimmicks, the food tastes of real stuff. You know, if he puts streaky bacon, it tastes of streaky bacon, but it might not come looking like a piece of streaky bacon, which is the great thing about food.
Yes.
And just as you walk in to the moment you finish, you're on a journey. I went to Charlie Trotter's as well, because you know, all these books, and he's quite a legend, isn't he, Charlie Trotter? So I wanted to go there to say I've done it. And then we flew back to New York, went to 11 Madison Park, went to The Spotted Pig, which was a gastro pub. We went to the Weedy 50, so we did, and then came back again. So it was quite a culinary tour. So I love doing things like that. Because as well as going out and experience new things, you know, you never know if you trigger off ideas, and it's just about educating yourself and seeing what other people are doing out there.
Very good.
And I think the States is something that's really up and coming.
Amazing.